Imagine, if you can, going through life without any legs. 10 years ago, Ken Easterday was born with abnormalities so cruel that his tiny limbs had to be amputated in order to help him survive. Today, Ken lives with his family in West Aliquippa, a Pennsylvanian steel town. At least, it was a steel town. But as the demand for steel has dwindled, so Aliquippa has become a town of long faces and longer bills, where roughly one family in two is on social security. It's a town jammed between the steelworks and the railway lines. A community where it's difficult to view the future with any confidence. Yet, it's a close-knit community, driven together perhaps by the problems of everyday living. This is home for 1,500 people. Their attitude to Kenny Easterday is totally supportive.
When you look at Kenny, you don't see him as a little boy without legs. I see more. I see Kenny with a heart, a soul. I see Kenny with needs, desires, just like any other child.
A 10-year-old boy. That's it. He's a normal 10-year-old boy, except he got his own, you know, he's got a little bit of a handicap. Imagine a handicap not there. What do you find? A 10-year-old boy.
Kenny just don't seem to think that there's anything wrong with him. You know, he just adapts to life and, yeah, he's just a happy-go-lucky kid. It's just, he's just one of a kind, that's all.
Ken is inseparable from his 13-year-old brother, Eddie. They live with their parents and close by their elder sister and their grandparents. It's a cozy, familiar world of play and talk and school.
What sort of grades do you get?
A's, B's, C's. No D's.
Hmm? No D's.
No D's.
First day I start, I got straight A's and straight B's.
Straight A's and B's, eh?
Now I got hard work timetables. Now if I go back to that school, I'll get division.
Division? Is that tough? Do you find mathematics tough?
Mm-hmm.
What do you find easy?
Reading.
That's a good one, Kenny, there.
It's like,
I took that.
The Easterdays have been married since 1967. Ken's father, Jesse, has been unemployed now for 3 years. Even though they had already had two normal children, both the Easterdays found themselves growing anxious that the pregnancy with Kenny was in some way different. When the baby was born, his legs were deformed and useless.
Kenny was almost 6 months old before I really accepted any of it. I just couldn't believe that it had happened. You know, I had two kids that were perfectly normal in every way. And then I had Kenny, and he was a little over 6 months old before I really accepted his handicap. Took me longer than it did him.
What were those 6 months like?
I don't know how else to say this, but pure hell. And it was hard. I didn't understand it. I didn't understand why, what the handicap really was, why it had happened to us.
Medically, Kenny was suffering from sacralogenesis, a genetic disorder that leaves a gap in the spine between the chest and the lower body. Dr. Green.
The lumbar spine, this area is missing, and the sacrum is missing, so that there is no contact between the chest or thorax and the pelvis, the part we sit on.
So the central nervous system would end where?
Central nervous system ends at the lower end of the thorax and is absent below.
So and anything that below that, there would be what? How much feeling would the child have?
None.
It was hard. I didn't know how to cope with it. And I didn't understand it. And I thought, well, if I pick him up this way, maybe something else will break. And basically, he took care of him the first few months. I took care of him, but not the way he should have been taken care of. I couldn't handle it.
Were you in a way rejecting him? Was that part of it?
No, I don't think so. I don't feel that I ever rejected him. I could sit and play with him. I could talk to him. But to do the things that needed to be done to him, I couldn't bath him. Up until he was about 7 months old, I had never bathed him. I was afraid of hurting him. I would stand there while he bathed him, and I would play with him and stuff, but to do it myself, I couldn't.
Were you loving him?
Oh, yeah. Every minute I loved him. You know, I would get up at night and play with him and sit and talk to him and make his bottles and everything that needed to be done, but I was afraid to hold him.
Today, their relationship could hardly be closer. So, how did they break down those barriers?
Kenny and I was left at home by ourselves one day, and Kenny was supposed to sleep, but he didn't. He woke up and he started to cry real hard. And I stood there and talked to him and played with his fingers and stuff, and he just kept grabbing up like this, and I just stood there and thought, oh, dear God, this is my baby. And I just bent down, picked him up, and he held on to me. He had hold of my face like this, like to say, well, it's about time, Mommy. After that, I was fine.
When Kenny was 6 months old, the doctors advised that he was going to need extra support if he was even going to be able to sit up properly.
The tibia, or shin bone, you might say, was taken and attached to the ribs here and came down to the pelvis there.
They amputated the remnants of his legs and used the bone to bridge the gap that nature had left below his rib cage. It was the first of a series of operations.
Came coming down.
The bony structure now gives extra protection to the liver and kidneys of this nimble, determined 10-year-old.
From day one, Kenny has always been a fighter. When he went into the surgery, he was, you know, he was small, so he basically didn't know anything that was going on. But the doctor said they never had no trouble bringing him back out of anything. He was always ready with those two fists. He was always ready.
I knew he was gonna make it, just because he had a deformity of the lower part of himself. You could just see it in the boy's eyes. He had a look there that. He wasn't giving up. He was going forward, and that's exactly what he did.
Was there never a part of you which, quite apart from emotionally, that felt in a way it might be better that he did die?
No, never. Never. Nope. That never even entered my mind. No.
Ken Easterday doesn't escape his share of the daily chores.
Can I help you?
He often shops for his mother.
Please. Two for four.
Okay, give me two, and give me one.
If he's lucky, he also shops for himself.
Well, that's okay. Give me a...
What kind of candy bars do you have?
No. No. Candy bars.
Candy. Oh, what kind?
He's very aware of the social handicaps of his condition. He has no control over his bladder, for instance, and he hates wearing diapers or a nappy. Another operation may help to put that right.
60 cents.
When you first see Kenny, you kind of back off. You know, it's a normal reaction. But after a while, everybody has just treated him like, you know, he belongs here, he's part of this town, he's part of us. Everybody is really good to him. There isn't anybody down here that would hurt him, and I would pity anybody that came into this town and tried to hurt him. There was a time when a couple boys had put him on a windowsill ledge at the Mellon Bank down here, and he was there for quite a while until one of the little girls around here went and put him back down on the sidewalk. Well, it wasn't the younger people that went after these young boys. It was the elderly people, 70, 80 years old, was going to beat these boys up. But as for that, we've never had no trouble down here at all.
But his mother worries if he strays far from home, four blocks away to Main Street, for instance.
I don't like not being able to at least hear the skateboard every once in a while. He upsets me if he takes off and he's gone longer than he knows he's allowed to be gone. Then I really lose my patience with him and I yell quite a bit at him. That's really about the only time I lose my patience with him. During school, I lose my patience quite a bit with him because he doesn't want to take a bath and he doesn't want to go to bed. But that's normal.
Just now, Ken is learning to swim, helped by friends and his brother, Eddie.
Good. I'm right beside you. Come on. You all right?
Yeah.
Go ahead, do it again.
Wait till we go up more. Watch out, Billy. Okay. Oh, Billy.
Okay, go ahead.
Basically, he gets along with everybody if he becomes nasty and hard to handle, then I know he's sick. Otherwise, he's usually very good at playing with the other kids.
He stands up for himself.
Yes, his father taught him that. I didn't like it, but his father taught him that.
What did you say to him, Jesse?
Like I told him, there's going to be all kind of bullies in this world, no matter where you live. There's no sense of you backing away because you're a handicap. There's always a way that you're going to get the best of the person that's standing up. I told him, if you have to, grab his leg, pull it out from under him, then get on top of him and stay there. And hit as hard as you can. Keep going.
Keep an eye on your brother.
The pool's lifeguard is George Holliday.
Like, since he doesn't have no legs, you have to keep a special eye on him when he's in a corners and stuff like that. And because if he gets scared, he gets away from the wall. And if he gets away from the wall, if he goes under, then you have to keep an eye on him. And then plus, when he's out of the water, he covers up with a towel and you can't see him. And any kids will come along a lot of times and kick things they don't, you know. And you got to be careful. You always got to keep an eye on him.
Kenny.
Yeah, give that towel down.
Yeah.
The one?
Yeah, get out of here.
Busy as he is, Ken tires easily.
The young kids, they treat him like he's different. He don't like that. He'll scare him. He'll chase him away. He'll just tell him, go, go. But the other kids, when the kids treat him like another kid, he's all right.
That's the answer, really, isn't
that's
it?
That's it. That's it, all in a nutshell. I don't even I don't think you could push me in if you tried.
Come on, you have to help me.
Hey, is this just a way to get close to her?
There.
Hey, Ken, one thing.
A lot of people tell me I should let loose a little bit, but I'm not ready yet. When I'm ready to let loose and let him go on his own a little bit, then I'll do it. But as far as things are right now, he's my baby, and if I want to be overprotective, I'll be overprotective. If he's gone too long, then I worry. There's always that chance, because he is so low, that he could get hit by a car. You know, I just don't like him being away too long. I don't trust strangers. I don't trust people, you know. There's always that fear that maybe somebody would deliberately try to hurt him or take him.
Just let him melt in your mouth.
I know.
One day, when he was 3 years old, someone tried to kidnap Kenny.
I had only left him for a few seconds to go into the other room. I went to the bathroom, and when I came back, he was gone. And whoever it was that took him at the time, Kenny must have screamed or something, and maybe they felt that I had heard him yell. They had dropped him at the end of our driveway and stuffed grass in his mouth, and I found him in a bunch of weeds with the grass in his mouth. And then after we cleaned the grass out of his mouth, he was so scared he couldn't tell us anything. I had called the police, but by the time they got there, there was no sign of nobody.
The only thing we tried to do was try to find the person who made the attempt. checked through the area where we lived at, but couldn't find no one.
You went out in the police car?
No, I went out through the woods. I was looking through the woods. Maybe see somebody going through the woods. I didn't see no one.
What if you'd found him?
I would have shot him. Right out, I would have shot him. I would have gave him the pain that he gave that little boy, my wife, of trying to kidnap him. I wouldn't have killed him, but I would have gave him pain to have made him think twice to grab a little child.
Ken was 8 years old when a skateboard came into his life. He was given it by a neighbor who'd lived 40 years in Aliquippa, Albert Romantine.
He wanted it, actually. I told him I was going to buy him, but he bugged me, too. So I had to buy it for him. I bought him a helmet, too, to go with it.
And he kept on at you, did he, until you did buy it?
Of course.
And when he'd got it, what did he do?
Up and down the streets. We had a good time with it. It made it easier for him to get around.
Never in my life would I have thought to buy him anything like that. I didn't understand what Albert thought Kenny was going to do, but to my amazement, he went flying up the sidewalk. Never had no problem with it. He learned to make it go. Within a half hour after he had it, he was gone.
How much of a release for him was it?
Well, I think tremendous. You want to keep up. I think one of the great problems, if you have difficulty walking or keeping up, is the group seems to go ahead, and you physically and emotionally feel you're falling behind. So anything to make you go a little faster than the other guy, I think, is a great psychological lift.
Unofficially, Ken frequently visits the local bar owned by Anthony Battellini, who also runs the town's only shop. Anthony has four boys of his own.
Kenny used to live right across the street from us. And one minute they're playing, and the next minute they're fighting. He's like any other kid. Sometimes he's bad, and he really is a good kid, though, really. He's a polite kid, he's well-mannered, and he's very intelligent for his age, too. Very intelligent.
You like him?
Oh, yeah, we all love him down here. He gets us mad at times, too, but...
And part of Kenny's routine is the Saturday morning visit to the Gospel Hall, where, through the week, he also has a free meal at lunchtime.
We teach them there's a God who loves them, a God who cares. We teach them purpose in life. We teach them that they were created by God for a purpose and a reason.
When you see someone like Kenny, do you ever question what you've just said?
No, I do not. I do not question it, no.
For what reason then was Kenny created, do you think?
Well, right now, I really don't know why Kenny was created, but I know he was created. And time will tell, for God's purpose. God has a purpose for Kenny's life. And right now, he brings a lot of love to people. He brings a lot of compassion. He causes people to count their blessings.
I didn't understand what I had done that was so bad that God was punishing me in this way. I felt that he was punishing me through Kenny, and I didn't understand why. And it was very hard for me to accept what I had done. You know, I kept trying to go back through my past, trying to think, what did I do? What did I do that was so bad that he's going to punish this baby like this? And Jesse basically had felt the same way. We didn't understand what we had done. And we felt that way for a long time. And then we were at one of my older brothers one day, and he just was sitting at the table talking to us, and he told us, he says, it isn't anything that you two did. He always said that. He says, God looked down on this earth, he says, and he picked out two special people to give that baby to. He says, and he gave Kenny to you and Jesse, he says, because he felt that you were strong and very special people. He says, you didn't do anything wrong. And then we were all right.
Every time I see Kenny, I believe one day there's going to be a set of legs on Kenny. I don't know how, when, or where, but I believe it. Our God is able, and I believe Kenny's going to be all right. As he grows up, there's going to be a way, and there's going to be a life for Kenny Easterday. I really believe this.
Would it matter to you that those were artificial legs that that help Kenny walk through the world?
No, it wouldn't. I just know that there'll be a way for him.
Can you, you can't wear them without that anymore, now?
No.
Okay. Want me to help you over there? You going on your own? Oh, pretty good.
Ken already wears artificial legs to school. As he grows, so the legs must be altered. He doesn't like the legs. He prefers the skateboard.
Just one with a swing through? See, there's one all day now.
But as he approaches his teens, his desire to look like everyone else will grow as well.
Got to keep an eye on here. Pull the socks up, you probably won't work as good with one sock down and one up.
The time is almost here when the skateboard won't be enough. And the doctors know this. Will Ken ever be able to wear these legs day in and day out?
No. Why do you say that?
The energy expenditure to walk with muscles that are from the thorax up is tremendous. So that I don't feel that he will be able to sustain gait for a long period of time. So I think that he will need some type of device similar to a wheelchair, and that he will have the legs to stand on and to work where height or that particular image is particularly important for him, or to walk short distances when he needs to work at a level that is standing.
And perhaps, too, to use the legs when socially it is better and he feels more comfortable.
No question.
Just hang on to him there, Sam, for a minute.
Today, a new plaster cast must be made to check Ken's growth.
Just the one. All right?
There you go.
All right.
Put my hands there.
See, I get to do all the work this time.
The lower part of Ken's body has no feeling, but he may yet be able to marry and have children. For the moment, the fact that the central nervous system extends no further than his rib cage means that his lower body acts as a sort of cushion that fits snugly into the top of the artificial legs.
Okay.
Help! Help!
They still need nothing.
I'm getting wet.
Yeah.
This is the hardest job I hate.
Viewed from any angle, Ken Easterday's problems as he faces his adult life are immense. But everything, even his condition, is relative.
I think there's a lot of children in this neighborhood that have a lot more problems than Kenny. They don't think straight, and like drugs, alcohol, things like this. Kenny's not on it. There's a lot of little 10-year-old boys in the world today that are on this. It's destroying their lives. But Kenny has a sound mind. And I believe Kenny uses what he has.
I'm lucky to have him. It's just mine, that boy. He's mine. I can't put it in any other words.
But bravely as he faces life, a different world exists outside West Aliquippa. A wide world, and in many ways, a wild one. Will Kenny be able to cope with the problems there? And will the family, particularly his mother, be able to let him go?
Kenny's a very determined young man right now. And as long as he keeps that determination up, he's going to be able to do anything that he wants to do. It's just that I'm going to have to learn that there's going to be a time I'm going to have to let go.
When do you think that'll be?
Well, I hope when he's about 40. He says he's leaving when he turns 18. I don't know. I hope by that time I'll be ready to handle the fact that he's a man now and I have to learn to let him go.